We have a sort of short special presentation before the formal talk. Professor Yeung, for those who went to the talk last night, he gave a fascinating talk on a folk singer in Hong Kong. And back in the 1970s, Professor Yeung was in Hong Kong doing recordings of this particular singer, and created a number of CDs. And so today, Professor Yeung was very kind to donate to the UBC Library a set of these recordings. So we're going to have a very brief but very grateful presentation of the gift to the library. So please come on. Ashby, our Asian librarian, and I would say that this is a particularly wonderful gift because, as you know, we have now a Cantonese language program, we have some courses on Hong Kong. So this is a great resource for those of us interested in Hong Kong and Cantonese music. So,
I'd like to add, I try not to repeat what Professor Swap did last night, because it was a very comprehensive introduction. And I'm going to talk about something more personal, like why do we bring Professor Yeung here? And I was trained as a musicologist, that is to say, to do Western music. And those of you who know a little bit about Hong Kong, you know that, wow, we have to specialize in science or arts at the age of 15, so that was really, really early. And when I was doing my undergraduate, I became a major. And his students taught back in the 90s at Chinese University of Hong Kong. So Professor Yeung's name is always in my head. You know, like imagine me, you know, this kind of 18-year-old kind of reading his work and listening to students talk about his work. And now, 20 years later now, kind of gray hair coming out of my head, and I really just want to check him out, if you will, just to see that my teacher's teacher. I just want to see him. It's a very, very simple thing. And so I talked to Leo over the summer, and just like, is there a way for us to bring him here? I really, really just want to see him. I want to talk to him. It's just like imagination, undergraduate imagination. It's kind of, what is he like? Okay, and so this is point number one. Number two is that I think I miss home. I miss my parents a lot. And so to do this helped me understand my parents. They were here in Vancouver for a month over the summer, and we did an event on Cantonese opera. And so for about 7 to 10 days, we just listened to just a lot of them, and just over the internet, being my dad, my mom, and myself. And I never felt disconnected with my parents on a general level. And I've been looking for ways to understand them on a deep level since I was young. And I just, you know, whenever I go back and we talk about this and that, and I never felt really close to him. And then I try to find ways to get closer to my parents. And I understand that to do archival work in France would not help me get closer to my parents. I mean, it took me years just to figure that one out, you know. And then I figured out, okay, for me to do this, I have to do something that I understand, that is to do music. And for me to do that, I need to change my direction, like from France all the way to Chinese music. And so it's a very personal journey for me, so it has a lot of meaning for me. So I miss my parents. I want to find ways to understand them and the Chinese culture. And Vancouver helped me understand that it's okay to be Chinese, and it took me years to understand that. And it's okay to be a Chinese student and to be a musicologist. It's just that we used to get to that point. So it's a very candid kind of little autobiography, and I look forward to exploring that culture that seems a little bit foreign to me. But at least I'm at this point that I really embrace this. I'm very, very curious, and I want to know more. And the first step is to say, okay, let's bring Professor Yeung here. Let's do it. And I think this is the right time to do this, for me anyway. And I hope some of you share my thinking and my aspiration. Thank you very much.
I'm very glad to be here to serve as your academic grandfather. So that you don't miss one that much. I want to first thank Professor Liu Xun and Heli for inviting me to share with you some of my research activities. And last night I talked about considered very lowly kind of music, blind singers singing opium dance and brothels. But today it's at the other end of the spectrum of Chinese music. It is specifically the Qi music. But let me, before I start talking about the content, let me just move on. I'm asking this very large, basic question. What is music? I think for us musicologists and ethnomusicologists, we are always very interested in trying to explain what is music in terms of language, in terms of words. But for musicians and music listeners and music lovers, they don't care to explain what is music. All they know is that when they hear good music and music they like, they know that's good music. But unfortunately for us, we always try to use language to explain and to communicate. And today, I'm going to, and we know, the musicologists, the scholars know that this, it's not a very simple question to answer. It depends on many different perspectives and points of view, and whether we're talking about the theory of music or the social function of music or the philosophy of music. There's so many ways to answer the question of what is music. So the point today, my purpose today is to try to answer this from a very, very specific point of view. And it's the point of view of Qi music. And for those of you who may not know what is a Qin, it is these days it's romanized as Q-I-N, but it's pronounced as like your chin. You remember your chin, except you have to lilt it. So don't say chin, but you should say chin. And this instrument called chin is, you can see seven strings stretched across a wooden sound box with no frets. It's a completely smooth. Actually, you can see this here. It's a real thing. And then there are, on the outer edge of the body, there are 13 markers which will help the left hand find its position. The right hand plucks mainly, and the left hand mainly stops the strings and move around on the strings. And there are. Here are two quotes I want to begin. Some of you musicologists will, of course, or ethnomusicologists know of the first quote by the eminent ethnomusicologist John Blacking. But the second quote, probably very few of you know, by the Song Dynasty Qin philosopher. Let me just read the second one. If one needs a kindred spirit, then one should play the qin. If not, then one had better put it in its cover and reserve it for one's own enjoyment. So it's a very different approach to qin, to music. While John Blacking, representing for all of us, whether we are musicologists or ethnomusicologists, we emphasize the social function of music. And music is you communicate music with other people. But here, Wu Cheng says that, no, you just, you play only for a kindred spirit, otherwise just put it away and you play for yourself. So I think that my basic premise is that this philosophy that represents Qin music really affects the answer to the question of what is music. So, and I hope by the end of this presentation, I can give you some sense of what is music based upon this particular way of particular kind of music. Now, the literati, Qin, is music is a special pastime, I suppose you can say, for the Chinese literati. But they are not the only people who play the qin. A parallel tradition are what we may call professional and artist qin players. And one of the music philosophers 10 years ago published a paper contrasting the literati qin with the, what he calls the artist qin, and summarizing in 6 points, and I shall very briefly go through it. First of all, the literati play primarily for themselves, and artists play primarily for others. And the second point is that the literati aim to immerse themselves in music. The artists aim to influence others. The third point is that the literati play the qin in order to grasp the musical content for themselves. The artists aim to communicate the musical content to others. The literati often play with little physical exertion, and using the techniques that are relatively simple and plain. The artists pursue technical perfection and richness so that the musical content may be effectively expressed. The literati treat the qin as a Taoist or Buddhist paraphernalia for achieving enlightenment and transcendence. The artists treat the qin purely as an instrument to make music and communicate music to the audience. Finally, the literati establish their reputation principally through their overall accomplishments, because the literati, besides their playing qin, many of them are also very accomplished painters and calligraphers and poetry composers. So qin activity is really part of this whole group of activities, and they are today the literati qin that we know of. They are mainly known as poets to a large extent, which I will cite some of their poems. In contrast, the artists establish their reputation purely on the basis of their musicianship, their musicians mainly. Now, I think what I like to focus on is number four. The literati often play with little physical exertion and using the techniques that are relatively simple and plain. Now, to me, that's slightly derogatory, isn't it? As if, you know, they don't really play very well, they're just very simple things. And my point is that this description of their playing is really linked very much to the fact that they play primarily for themselves. The fact that they play for themselves affects their way of play, which is, I hope, my presentation will show you. Now, I'm going to show you several wonderful paintings that show, to illustrate the literati playing mainly for themselves or for their kindred spirits. Now, one thing I want to apologize is that this projector distorts the painting a little bit, so you have to adjust to it squeezes the height dimension. So these paintings really should be narrower and longer, but however, it doesn't matter to understanding the content. So these are really very famous painters throughout history, and I have the dates to get a sense of where they are from. And this is a painting called Playing Qin Under the Trees. And this is quite a typical painting of qin playing by the literati. The whole painting essentially is a panoramic view of nature, of mountains and rivers and wonderful scenes. And then, usually at the corner, then you can see here these are the qin. There's a qin player and with two listeners. And this is very, very typical, that nature is in fact the main point, and qin players are there just to immerse themselves in nature. And here is another one, it's called Playing Qin Under a Plum Tree. So this person is I think you can see it very clearly that he actually has a chin across his lap. And there are two people there, but they are not your ordinary audience. They are his servants, serving him tea or whatever incense. And his little head, you can see that he's facing out, facing the mountains and valleys and the tree when he's playing the qin. Another painting is called Playing Qin by the River. So you can see him, and you can see it has a qin across his lap. And he's really playing facing nature, facing the water, and facing the mountains. Very typical of depicting how qin is played. And here is another one. In fact, it is a slightly different stand. It says that a scholar taking a break from playing qin, Ping Qin Dao Shi Fu, and here is a qin. And he's tired or something, so he decided to take a break and admire the nature without his qin. This is a very famous painting by the Song Dynasty Emperor, Zhao Ji, listening to qin. And you can see this is the qin player, and there are two of his kindred spirits. They are both more literati, playing, appreciating his music. And here is a drawing, a woodcut drawing of a qin player playing for a friend. And you can see there are some books and some paintings, and these are all what scholars are involved in. And then there are these servants who are preparing some tea for their master. And this is another very well-known painting called Playing Qin for a Friend. And I find this one is particularly important because he's sitting so close, he's almost hovering over the instrument. And that's going to be very important in my talk, too. So now, next, I turn to several poems. Two of them that I'm citing here is by this very famous Tang Dynasty poet, Bo Ju Yi. And the first one is called Playing the Qin at Night. The tong wood from Shu is dense. The silk strings from Chu produce clear sounds. I play the slow melodies unhurriedly, a few tones in the deep of night. To the ear they may be plain, yet they please me with deep feeling. I start and pause at will, not needing or wanting anyone else to hear. And second poem is called Playing the Tune of Autumnal Thoughts. When I play autumnal thoughts at leisure, on the spur of the moment, the tune is clear, the sound frank, the lingering tones slow and sparse. More so each day, I am pleased that no one hears me, for I myself alone know the goodness of my playing. Actually, here I have a trouble translating the Chinese word ge, qin ge. Ge is a very difficult word to translate. I'm sure those of you in poetry or in philosophy, you know, ren ge or qin ge, shi ge. It's a general term describing a certain it's a value judgment. You know? And so, if you some, I know there are very various friends who are Chinese scholars here, if you can help me find a better word for goodness. At one time I translated as the integrity of my training, but I'm not happy with any of these translations. But you can tell from these two poems, the essence there is on the value of playing for oneself rather than playing for other people. And I'd like to cite a third poem by poet Han Yingshan. And he says, his poem says, if I play, it is not for others, not even for Zhong Zi Qi, I sit before my instrument and my fingers move over the strings of their own accord. Flowing waters and high mountains are in my thoughts. Why should other people need to know that? I should just explain very briefly who is Zhong Ziqi. There is this story that almost all Chinese know about Bo Ya. They live in mythical times. Bo Ya is an expert Qin player, and he cannot find anybody who can understand his music. Finally, one day, he found somebody called Zhong Ziqi, who really understands his Qin. So, and he's the only person who can understand his playing. So, the day when Zhong Ziqi died, Bo Ya said, "Oh, there's no point in my playing anymore," so he smashed his Qin. So that poem says that not even for Zhong Ziqi, he doesn't even need somebody like Zhong Ziqi, making reference to this mythical story of Bo Ya and Ziqi. And Flowing Water and High Mountains are two very famous Qin pieces. In fact, they are associated with Zhong Ziqi and Yu Bo Ya, who is the Qin player, that Yu Bo Ya played the High Mountains. And then Zhong Ziqi immediately knows that, "Oh, you are playing the High Mountains." And when he plays Flowing Waters, Zhong Ziqi immediately understands that that piece is what he's playing. So that's why he said he has these two pieces in my thoughts, and he doesn't need anybody to know that, not even Zhong Ziqi. Now, I cite this poem in particular, but personal significance is because we have a calligraphy of the poem. And the calligraphy is by one of my teachers, Madame Cha, the teacher Cha, who, like a typical literati, she is a calligrapher, and she is a poet, and she is a Qin player. So she admires this poem very much, so she calligraphed it for posterity. And we go back to my teacher, Cha, who has a calligraph, her own essay called Wu Qin Ming, and I think I translated it as an artistic cradle or a Qin cradle. And I'm not going to go through the entire essay. It's really a 6-foot long scroll that she hangs on the wall of her study. Every time she moves, the scroll will move with her. It's always there. The first phrase, it says that Yin Yin Study, that's the name she gave to her study, is where I take delight and amuse myself with Qin music and calligraphy. Zi Yu, for myself. So it shows again a sentiment that she is really doing it for herself. And then now we go back to my first few slides when I cite John Lacking and the Chinese Qin philosopher called Wu Cheng. He's well known for having 10 rules on playing Qin, and each rule says that you should play. You should play Qin in such and such a situation, and you should not play Qin in such and such a situation. And in the 10th one, he writes, "Playing the Qin is meant for nurturing one's nature. Therefore, one should not aim at acquiring fame by it. If one needs a kindred spirit, then one should play. If not, then one had better put the Qin in its cupboard and reserve it for one's own enjoyment." I think I've pounded enough upon you on this philosophy, a way of looking at when we should play the Qin and when we should not play the Qin. There are too many words that maybe you shouldn't try to read this long paragraph. All I want to say that is that many of you know that at the beginning of the 20th century, the last dynasty collapsed. And along with the collapse of the imperial dynasty is the dissolution of the literati class. So Qin playing also affected very much because we no longer have this very privileged class of literati who doesn't have to worry about a livelihood and who has the leisure to enjoy their poetry and painting and calligraphy and Qin music. But even with the collapse of the literati class, there's still a very small number of Qin players who are no longer consider the literati class because they are no longer in this very privileged small number of Chinese who I guess in today's parlance, they are using taxpayers' money to support them because the government supports them fully. So they don't need to worry about money and livelihood. But of course, after the 20th, beginning of the 20th century, people no longer can rely on that. So there are professionals of other kinds, but they continue to play the Qin, but they still follow the ideology of the literati's Qin playing. And I not want to mention two of them, because they are my two teachers. The first one, I already mentioned her, Cha Deyun, my woman teacher, female teacher from Hong Kong, who passed away quite relatively recently at a very advanced age. She's she's very, very well educated, because she's from a very elite scholarly family. But she's spent most of her life being a housewife and raising a son. So she has no independent means of living, but she plays the Qin mainly for herself. And we have seen the panel that she wrote, it's called the Artistic Cradle that I mentioned. And she really shunned, because she passed away about 10 years ago exactly, public performances. In his younger days, people would ask him and she would ask her, she would just play in a very small number of concerts. But then, afterwards, she refused to play in public anymore. And she refused to make any recordings, even though her students, like myself, would urge her to make a recording so that people in future generations can hear you. She refused to. Oh, actually, she did try. And I remember I tried to make it as easy as possible. But every time I record her, she made mistakes and she would stop. And so finally, I gave up recording her performance. But I and her other small number of students, we had our private little cassette recordings when we took our lessons, mm-hmm. and she doesn't mind our recording it when because we said that we really wanted when we go home to practice. So she let us make these recordings on really very cheap little cassette recordings. So finally, when did we publish this? In the early, about 2000, the several students, we gathered all our practice recordings and then picked the best ones. Because they are all really very poorly recorded and there's a lot of noise and finally we gathered together and about 20 pieces that represent her repertory and we asked for her permission, can we publish this set of recordings? She's very reluctant in the beginning, but finally she allowed us to do that. I know why she's reluctant. One reason is that because there are a lot of noises and then she made errors and then some of the pictures are not exactly right. But we try to convince her that doesn't matter. It's the entire piece that is important that we should preserve for future generations. So we did publish that in a two-volume set of CDs, all of her play. The second teacher, Yao Bingyan, my teacher Yao, is from Shanghai. He really died very young, as you can see, from 21 to 83. And I studied with him for only three short summers. And he spent all his life as an accountant in some business set up. But in all his spare time, he would practice the Qi. And just like my teacher Tai, he really didn't like performance. In his younger days, he would agree to play a few concerts, but then in his older days, he just refused all public performances. And even more so, he refused to have students. And he really has only two or three students, other than he has two sons who play the Qi. That he taught very much. Teachers Hagas have a larger number of students. I would say she has about a dozen very close students. But what's important for us to know from both these teachers is that they never charge tuition. And my teachers have put it in a very nice way. She said that, "You are not my students, you are my friends. And I will teach you only because I like you as a friend. It's not because I'm teaching you as a Qin student." And that's how they approach teaching other people. Now, in contrast, we have two artists, professional Qin players, and they are very famous in China. The first one is Gong Yi from Shanghai, and the second one is from Li Xiangping from Beijing, and they perform very widely and charge very high admission tickets, and they have many, many students, and they charge very high tuition, and they also establish these Qin competitions, which they will serve as adjudicators, and Qin examinations in eight grades, grade one, grade two, until grade eight. And they, all their students, will serve as examiners. So they are certainly now these days the most influential Qin players, and everybody knows their names. So I think they can be considered the typical kind of artist, professional Qin players, and they are very, very good players, absolutely technically just brilliant. Otherwise, they won't get to be where they are. But still, I want to impress upon you that these two kinds of Qin players, the literati player and the professional players, which exist throughout the long history of Qin playing, two parallel streams of schools of playing, still exist today. You know. But I have to say that these professional players now are very, very powerful, mainly because of the media and the technology that it's very much easier for people to know about them, like in earlier times. But today, they are becoming very, very famous, and that's why they are very influential. So our sense of what is Qin music, to a large extent, is based upon their playing. And this is why I'm trying to make the contrast between private playing and public playing, because they belong to the public music. And their kind of music actually is not different from what we are familiar here. There's a concert pianist, or conductor, or an opera singer. They are all very public musicians, and these very accomplished musicians, pianists or singers, they reach out trying to impress upon the audience. And we are all very impressed by wonderful singers and musicians. So they are very similar to the tradition of classical music or popular music in the West. So there's nothing very special in that respect. In contrast, the literati musicians to me are quite unique because there are really no such phenomenon existing. Now, of course, there are a lot of private music. We know that when we take a shower, we talk, or when we walk, we sing to ourselves, or we sing a lullaby to our babies. These are all private music that we know of. But the Qin private music is quite different, partly because the Qin, the literati musicians share the same repertoire and the same techniques and the same, very much the same aesthetics as the public musicians, except the major difference is that they only play for themselves, and that affects their way of playing. Again, there are too many words, I'm sorry. One of a well-known musician called Wu Zhao from Beijing, he said that, he wrote, some Qin players may fall into the rut of simply show off virtuosity at the expense of inner artistic expression. So we know where he stands. and he also said that those who promote performing for an audience naturally will demand a drastic increase of the loudness of Qin music, which will result in a decrease of the Qin's special flavor. You can see he's critical of the so-called professionals. The earlier, one of the professional Qin players, Gong Yi, the first one I mentioned from Shanghai, he promotes playing Qin with a large ensemble, and in fact he created Qin concertos. And so Wu Zhao said that when the Qin is accompanied by a large ensemble of other instruments, the need to coordinate rhythm and to produce a coherently unified sound would inevitably affect some of the Qin's special and distinctive qualities. As a solo instrument characterized by its subtle and ambiguous tones and melodic movements and irregular and free rhythm. So I think what he said is all very true. When one plays by oneself and for oneself, it's much freer. And as one of the poems says that, I start and pause at will. It doesn't have to answer to an audience. You know? In a public concert, we can't do that. You know, when we start a piece, we're supposed to finish the piece. So Wu Zhao pretty much summarized the basic differences then, between the two. But then, I want to cite or quote two scholars. The first one is Liu Chenghua. He's the one who wrote the article on the six contrasting, six elements that contrast private music, literati music, and artist music that I showed you an earlier slide. And he writes that literati Qin provides the tradition with its basic spirit and soul, while the artist Qin provides the life and blood. And another well-known Qin player scholar, she just retired as a professor of philosophy from Baptist University in Hong Kong, she writes that one camp has soul but no pulse. The other camp has pulse but no soul. Now, I don't know, I want to argue that whether the artist's Qin has no soul, but I want to argue that saying that the literati Qin has no pulse and no life, that is very, very unfair, and it's wrong. This is what they are implying, contrasting to, I guess this is where equivalence.
Equivocation?
Pardon me?
Force.
Force equivalency.
the way that Trump says, oh, you know, there are good people, there are good people there. So I think they are trying to have some false equivalency to say something good about each camp. But I don't agree with them that the Lithuanian teaching has no life and no blood. And that's what I want to impress upon you in the second half of my presentation, which of course I may not be able to finish because I've already used up a lot of time. Oh, too many words left to say. So the only one I want to impress upon you is that the life and blood and pulse must be assessed with private music in mind. And I would say that people generally think of life and blood of music is based on public music, because that's the kind of music that people write about and research into and publish and analyze. So our concept of the value of music, or what is music, is really basically from public music. But I think when we assess private music, whether there is life or blood or pulse, we must consider the fact that the musicians, the Qing musicians, play for themselves. And I would, so many points I want to make. The first one is the degree of audibleness, because from the public music's point of view, they always criticize Qing is too soft. Nobody can hear it. So what's the point of playing for the public? And the second one is the subtle shadings of individual tones, which Wu Zhao has made reference to. And they are so subtle that unless you are sitting right here, you will not be able to hear such nuances. And the third one is the aesthetic principle of harmoniousness, which I've explained. Then the visual, tactile, and kinesthetic perceptions. To me, I think that, I know many of you are musicians, as musicians, of course, the oral dimension is we consider it as the most important, particularly from the listener's point of view. But as musicians, we are also very much aware of the visual, actually even from the audience point of view, the visual dimension is considered very important, because I know that when people go to a piano recital, they always want the seat slightly to the left or center, so that they can see the hands of the pianist. That shows how important is the visual aspect. And we all enjoy Yo-Yo Ma's playing, visually it's so impressive. And the conductor, Leonard Bernstein and others. Certain music, like Qing music, unless you're sitting right there, I can see my fingers very, in great detail. But people sitting far away will not be able to really appreciate that. But even more so is the tactile perception, that the fact that we touch the strings, to me, is very important. I mean, I'm a pianist. I think even for piano playing, the touch is so important. I want to feel my fingers on the keys. And Qing player is particularly important when I'm going to talk about some of the techniques of playing, that the tactile part is important and so significant, and yet we know that the tactile part, anyone else will not sense it. You know, it's beyond an audience capability to understand the tactility of a musician. And even more so is the kinesthetic perception. I think, again, I use piano playing as an example. I just find that running my fingers on the keyboard and sometimes you cross over and all kinds of things. The sense of muscle control, to me, is very important. And it's beyond tactility. It's really the inner sense of muscle movement and control. And that is particularly so for Qing playing. The kinesthetic sense of our sense of what our fingers are doing, what our wrists are doing, and what our arms and shoulders are doing. This dimension certainly is not perceptible by an audience. So, the notation and compositional principles, I hope I have a few minutes to talk about it, and importance of programmatic content to the performer. So I will go through these very briefly, I think. First of all, the nature of the instrument is quiet in this. It's due mainly to the silk strings, the traditional ancient strings are made of silk, and they are very soft. I mean, I can two notes, and I think only you people can hear. And this is the loudest sound, playing open string. And partly because it's made of silk, it has very low resonant time. And secondly, the body itself is a very small resonating chamber, so it doesn't really project the sound very much. But for the chin player, I can hear it very well, so there's no need for other people to hear it if I'm true literati chin player. Now, of course, today, because of the electronic media, we can amplify the chin, and then we can record it, we can listen to the CD, we can crank it up to very loud. So this becomes a moot issue. But for live playing and live listening, it's still a very crucial point. I want to say that these days, since the establishment of the People's Republic, there has been some modification of the qin based upon their belief that it should be more public. So instead of using silk strings, they have been using metal strings and various other kinds of strings, which is definitely louder and serves public music better. But some of us overseas qin players, we insist on still using silk strings. So that is one major issue in qin playing. So, and then the delicacy of silk strings, that it breaks quite easily. So we always have to be very careful when we tune the strings. We should not tune it too high, because particularly if you are doing a public performance, if the string breaks, oh, then everybody has to take a break of 20 minutes before I put on a new string. So it's terrible for the silk string because it's so delicate. And also, going back to the first point, is that the silk is very sensitive to humidity. So when I play the qin, when the qin player is playing, the touch of the strings with my fingers and breathing on it certainly will affect the tuning of the string. So if you do a public performance, if people pay money to listen to you, then it would be terrible if in the middle you start having a tune every time you tune, certainly after the piece. So these are some of the drawbacks that people feel that the traditional silk string has, besides its being so quiet. So the reform of the instruments, so now, this instrument has been more or less like this for about 2,000 years and has not changed. So it is very interesting. In the history, has there been some time when people try to make it louder? Like today in China, when people feel that it should be more for the public, which means that it should, and at that time there's no amplification. I assume there must be some experiments, but I have not gone into doing the research. But all I know is that until about the middle of the 20th century, it's still essentially the same construction and the same silk strings. So whatever experiments people might have attempted in the past did not last. That my explanation is that the literati, they don't care. They're playing for themselves, so they don't care for the instrument to be louder or softer, so long as they can hear themselves. That's right, and I use it to compare it with the piano, the European piano, and some of you may know, the piano's earlier generation, several generations back, is a clavichord, which is very, very soft. And it's even softer than the qin. And then gradually, through the centuries, there are composers who want their music to be more brilliant and technically, you know, more reach the audience. And there's also the social factor that piano music becoming more and more commercialized and reaching to the public. So the piano itself then gradually changed from very soft to slightly louder to slightly even louder. And of course, by about the middle of the 19th century, is the grand piano is really very loud and brilliant, and it really serves composers like Liszt and Brahms very well because of the change of the construction of the piano. I think in contrast, qin music, qin instrument has never changed. Partly because the literati never felt the need to reach out to the public. They're very happy to play for themselves, so there's no need to change. And the 20th century changes I've already mentioned, mainly to change the strings, and they make the qin a little bit bigger, and they amplify in public performances. And I already mentioned overseas qin players like me and some of my colleagues, we insist on still playing the qin. Sometimes we cannot resist the request to play for people. Then either, like for instance, in this audience, I can play some pieces for you. You people cannot hear it very well, or unless you sit right here. And then I consent to its being amplified, because otherwise, what's the point of playing? You can just see the fingers and hands movement, but you cannot hear anything. So these are the electronic amplification. It's a really important innovation. All right, now I'm going to go through some of these, but I will really go through very, very quickly. When should I start? Okay.
Honestly,
the
band can play something if you
have. No, I'm not prepared to play anything. I may play a very, very short piece. Very short piece, but when should I start?
We go to
the
dinner
tomorrow,
so we want to
end it up. That's shortly after, but I would like to have some time for you to ask some questions. So here I have, these are the four very primary methods of plucking. And they range from the loudest to the softest. The loudest is called the open string sound, the tone that I play the pitch. This is considered the loudest note. And the next one is the wood tone. I stop at one point and then play the pitch. So already they are less resonant. And the third one are the harmonic or fan tones. And then the zhou shou yin is the, I doubt you people can hear me, because after plucking the string, my finger moves to another point, and then I can hear this pitch. You only can hear me rubbing the wood, but these are the sort of moving hand pitches, the softest kind of pitches. So these are the four primary ones, and these are all written into the musical notation. You have no choice. If you follow the notation, you have to either play a stop note or open string or a sliding note. Then there are some sort of secondary techniques of plucking. The first one is the difference between a nail tone and a flesh tone, because one can pluck it in two ways, either pluck it, this is a flesh tone, I pluck it inward, mainly it's the fleshy part of the finger, the other one is plucking outward, mainly the nail part. there's very subtle differences in the timbre there. And the male tone tends to be, you can anticipate, expect it to be slightly brighter, while the flesh tone is slightly mellower. And then the left hand actually is not just the plucking is not only left to the right hand, the left hand can also make sound, and one is called tui chu, pushing out. You're stopping it here and you push out the string and then releasing it. You can hear it's very soft. And the second one is called fortuitously lifting up. Now the left hand may be pressing, stopping at a particular point is a wood tone, you know, but then it has to move to another place. And so fortuitous, by lifting up, it cannot help but producing a tone. So and in some Qin handbooks or notations, it becomes an intentional one. It says that 大喜, you just when you lift your finger, you let the sound like that. And the third one is called fang. It's sort of like pushing out, except it's not applied to the outer string in outer position, but applied to an inner string. And when you have to move to another place, instead of lifting up, you want to move by like this, you know, letting go to move to another place, so that your finger doesn't leave the fingerboard. It's called fang, letting go. Then there are two other ones used by the left hand, is that if the left hand happens to be stopping at one point, it wants to stop a place somewhere here, about an arm, a hand's way distance, and then pluck it like that. So what it produces is really a wood tone, but it's only played by, but it's played by the left hand instead. It's called cha qi. Then the left hand finger can also do something called a virtual an, a shi an. You press down in from mid-air. And so you it's a better translation, it's arm from mid-air. Yeah, that's very, very nice. Tactfully and kinesthetically. And yes, the last one is called nian. And that is, actually that's very loud, because I will pull the string up and let it snap back. So it has a sort of percussive sound related to it. And then there are tertiary factors. That is, these strings all have different thicknesses. So these strings can produce the same pitch depending on where you stop it. But because they are all the thicknesses are all different, the volume of sound and the timbre of sound will all be different depending on which string you use. And secondly, on the fingers, because our fingers all have slightly different width, the middle finger is the widest, and then this is slightly narrower, actually the thumb is the widest. So, theoretically speaking, that when we pluck it, the sound, or the level of dynamics, and the timbre really depends on which finger we use to pluck, because of the different surface areas. Then the last one is there are various mu tones, wood tones, that you can manipulate to produce things which are very much like our vibrato. So I'm stopping here, wood tone. And this is called yin, the third one is the yin. The zhu is you slide it down from higher pitched area, or sliding up from the lower pitched area. And then the finally now is a very special kind of vibrato that it really defines defined more by movement than by movement. The movement should be so partly it's speed, partly it's pressure that you start from pressing it hard, but come moving up slightly, lifting it, and go down again. That's called now. It's something we don't have it in Western. I mean, we do have the yin, and in Qin playing techniques, there is the fast yin. There's a slow yin. There is a narrow yin, and there's a wide yin. And there are many, many other kinds of yin. And the most ridiculous kind of yin, I think we all can laugh, but this is all written down in some theoretical technique books, is that you let it ring yin, let it affect the vibrato, but not moving your finger at all. And how do you get the yin effect? Well, let the blood pulse. You feel that pulse affecting the pressure on the string. Now, this is sort of like quite mystical, but this is written as one kind of yin. And all these zhu and zhuo and yin and most of them are written into the notation, but sometimes we can add all right, let me move on to a different topic, and I don't think it's already time to stop. one of the most important theoretical writing is by Xu Shanying, this person living in this period. It's called Xi Shan Qing Fa, and we translate it as the Xi Shan Treatise on the Aesthetics of Chinese. So it's all on and he lists 24 aesthetic principles or aesthetic qualities, and each of them is in terms of one Chinese character. And many of them, those of you who are in painting or calligraphy or poetry, you can see that they share. These are all literatis, leisure activities, and they share certain very basic philosophical ideas. And this is specifically for the Qin, and it's very difficult to translate using a similar English word, because even the Chinese word, according to this theoretical this treaty, each word has a paragraph explaining what it means. And actually, there is a colleague of mine from Hong Kong has translated the entire treatise, including all the explanations. So it's quite an accomplishment. So this is one step towards for non-Chinese readers to try to understand it. But even for Chinese readers, it's not always easy to understand Chinese writing from the Ming Dynasty and Wei Qing. Or Qing Dynasty. So, or Ming Dynasty actually is still. So even for Chinese readers, it's not easy to understand. You can see all these one-word summary of the aesthetic ideal that one has to achieve. What I want to just mention is the first one, harmoniousness. I think the reason why he puts in the first one is, as a reason, it's the most important one. And harmoniousness of her is not just for playing Qin, it's in Confucian philosophy. Confucian philosophy also lists her as the most important quality for the society. Because Confucian philosophy really aims at people's livelihood and people's well-being and people's happiness for those who live together in a community. And to Confucius, the most important principle is her, is for living in harmony. For this theoretical treatise, it also lists her as a harmony. Now, harmony as a first principle, it's, there are too many things to explain. Well, this is very something very simple. In tuneness, I mentioned that the silk strings get out of tune very, very easily. So making it in tune is something that's very important to us, our ears. When two strings are in tune, we sense that everything is fine. When they're out of tune, our ears and our mind get grated in the wrong way. So that is the first thing, is that you always learn to tune the instruments. We don't have a piano tuner for the pianist. We all have to be our own tuner to make sure that they are in tune. And particularly after playing the piece, we have to tune it again to make sure that it's in tune. And when they are in tune, we feel that things are fine. And even though Qin music is more monophonic music, it doesn't have the various complicated harmonic theory as in Western music, but it uses unison and octaves and fifths quite often, and they are used to add temporal interest to a piece of music. And also, the unison octaves are particularly important in compositions where some very often there's an echo of sound. When one plays a pitch, see, I play an open string tone followed by a harmonic tone, but they are really an octave. But very often pieces will end with this pitch, and then it will be echoed by another pitch, which essentially is the same pitch, but a different octave, but at a different from a different technique. So it's a slightly different timbre between the open string pitch and the harmonic pitch. And this kind of echoing happens a lot in Qin compositions to add interest rather than complicated harmonic changes. They just put in these echoes of different, the same pitch, or sometimes they are a fifth apart, just to add certain musical interest. So this is one of the meaning of harmoniousness. Now, I want to just mention one other meaning of harmoniousness that this this author wrote. He said that the Qin player playing Qin music involves four elements: the string, the finger, the tone, and the thought. And I think, of course, harmonious must have concordance between string and finger. And you have to take the right string. And then between the finger and the tone, it produces a tone. So these should be in concordance. And lastly is the tone and the thought. So it involves one's perception and one's sense of this tone. And so my point is that this theory of harmoniousness cannot be appreciated by outside listener, particularly in the finger and the string and the finger. Only I can understand the relationship. And certainly not the tone and the thought. Now, of course, the audience can have their own thought. That's a different matter. But it doesn't share with the Qin player thought. So this is another way of understanding harmoniousness, is to make sure that these four elements are in concordance. Okay, now, I've already mentioned the oral, visual, tactile, and kinesthetic perceptions. I think maybe you have got an idea, but actually I want to mention to you that this is an article that will come out in Ethnomusicology Journal in the next issue. So you want a fuller understanding, you can go and read it. It's coming out in November. I just did the proofread. But at this point, maybe I should, let me see, is there any last, I really want to make the visual part is so important. So this particular technique of two fingers playing two strings, it's illustrated by, on the left side is a drawing of how we should do it, and the right side is a sort of a representation in real life of a dragon grasping a piece of cloud. That's what we should imagine. So that's why it's the visual representation is just so important. Another one is, I just want to mention, so many animals are mentioned, phoenix, rhino, seagull, woodpecker, dragonfly, butterfly, fish, and then crane, cicada, tortoise, crow, canary, monkey. And finally, there are some references, not necessarily to animal, but to a finger position. So this particular way of stopping the string is called to gui, or to kneel, which to me is really, you know, it's like this. You really look when you are kneeling, kowtowing to somebody. All right, maybe I should stop here because, as I said, I think I made my point clear that the evaluation of the music of the Lipra teaching has to be based on different factors and criteria. Thank you very much.